Good morning, viewers. You are welcome to this edition of Electoral Reform on the Weekend Show. My name is Ariyo Dare Atoye. On this edition, we'll definitely be looking at different aspects of the electoral reform with a special focus on the independence of the Electoral Commission, INEC. How independent is the eye in the commission? And I am not alone today. I have a new partner, somebody who probably you'll be seeing time to time every weekend, and is here with me. She's no other person than Banke Ilori Oyeniyi. You're welcome, Banke.
Thank you for having me. Good morning, Nigeria.
Thank you, Banke. Definitely, this edition, we are going to look at something that happened during the week. Our own organization, Center for Liberty, submitted a letter to the President of the Senate in which we demanded that the Senate should not embark on recess, that's the annual recess for 2020, until the Electoral Act amendment is done and dusted as Electoral Act 2020 repeal and reenactment. And that's the demand of Nigerians at this moment.
I'm Sam Osichukwu. And here are three ways to fix elections in Nigeria. The first is a legislative review of our electoral laws with a special focus that guarantees the autonomy of institutions that partake in our elections. This would help their loyalty to be focused on the nation and not to the pockets of the political paymasters that have dictated our electoral tunes. Let the eye return to INEC.
The second priority would be to develop a complete legal framework that would improve the integrity and the independence of the electoral system and also ensure the consistency and the transparency at the electoral management. This can be done by the passing of the Electoral Reforms Bill at the National Assembly. And my third priority would be to increase the level of security, as history has always shown violent attacks on voters, on electoral officials, and even members of the opposition.
Thank you very much. Now to our segment proper, where I will be looking at the I in INEC, which some people have said that it is not autonomous, not independent enough. And I think this one area that I think we really need to actually look at as part of our electoral reform. So I would like to have your thought on this, even though this is not really a question and answer segment, but a sort of interaction between you and myself. So what is your thoughts about what Nigerians are talking about in terms of the having INEC being really independent?
Oh, well, for an organization like the INEC to actually truly perform its responsibilities, its constitutionally provided for responsibilities, it is important for them to truly have the opportunity to carry out those duties that have been set aside. And independence of INEC is essential to the discharge of their duties. A lot of Nigerians have complained about this because we see from time to time interference of political stakeholders while INEC conducts its activities.
Absolutely. That's something very actually troubling for all Nigerians in every election cycle. Mm. We saw it in 2019, we saw it in 2015, and for it not to repeat itself, and I think that's why you and I are here today for us to have a sound and enduring electoral reform. So, how do you think we should go about this? Because I have my own thoughts. Let me have your thoughts so that I can also make my own point.
Okay, first we need to look at the selection process of the chairman of INEC. We need more transparency in that regard, because usually there's a saying that goes, he who plays the piper dictates the tune. So when you have an INEC chairman who has been appointed by the president and who works at the discretion, so to say, of the president, he would always try to ensure that he's in the good books of the person who has appointed him. So the first port of call, as far as I'm concerned, is with respect to the appointment of the INEC chairman.
Yeah, thank you very much. I think one area where the CSOs and a lot of people, you know, in the civil society dropped the ball was when former President Jonathan lost the 2015 election. So there was that assumption that because Jonathan appointed Jega and yet he lost the election, that INEC is somewhat independent. Well, that's really not true.
Yes.
If I can agree, I mean, I also want to agree with you that we need to put in place a lot of transparency. For instance, we can borrow a leaf from other clients like Ghana and some other places, and I think you have an idea of what works in Ghana.
Oh, yes. The president of Ghana appoints the INEC, their own INEC chairman, based on the consultations with the Chief Justice of Ghana and in line with the discussions and dialogues that they have with the members of the Council of State. So it's somebody who has been properly vetted by the judicial arm of their country and is being recommended to the president, and in conjunction with the statesmen, the elder statesmen of the country,
Council of State,
so
yes.
that we can have someone who would truly reflect the wishes of the people and who has an understanding of the issues at stake.
And I think in addition to that, if we really want to do something here in Nigeria, why can't we have something similar with what happened in Ghana with a remodel, in a remodeled fashion? For instance,
yes.
we can have the NJC setting up a committee, and this committee would, or a panel, would definitely call for applications, select the best three Nigerians, probably two exams, and these three are recommended by the NJC, that's the CGN, to the president. And the president, in consultation with the Council of State, would definitely select one person among the three, and this person is sent to the National Assembly, especially the Senate, for confirmation. And also in this electoral act that we are talking about, I think the power to fire the INEC chairman should be taken away from the executive. That's my own belief.
Definitely. Like I said earlier, your loyalty, if you're appointed by someone, your loyalty would naturally lie to that person. So when the powers are less concentration of powers with the executive with respect to the appointment and dismissal of key officers like the INEC chairman would really go a long way to ensure that the person can do his or her job without fear or favor.
So to our viewers at home, electoral reform advocacy is something that we are seriously committed for us at Center for Liberty and for Banker at
Raising
the Voices, and we are all committed to this. And please always follow the hashtag Give Us Electoral Reform or Pass Electoral Bill to continue with this discussion. It's an ongoing discussion. We are happy that the Senate is now responding and said they are committed to 2020 passage of that. And I think this should excite us, Banke.
Yes, because like we have stated earlier that in conversations with respect to electoral reforms, that the time frame for which this will be done is very important. We have less than 1,000 days to the next elections. So it is very important for us to fix this now and get it done. I remember that one of the reasons that the president gave with respect to why he couldn't assent to the previous amendments was that it was too close to the elections. So if we can conclude the legislative processes in good time, the president would be able to assent to the new act.
So thank you again to our viewers. Thank you, Banke. Banke is my co-presenter. Definitely you'll be seeing more of us every Saturday. And thank you to the team at The Weekend Show.